give a big round of applause to the speakers of our day. It's Kashmir Reading, Siddharth, Gigoo, Sahil, Maqbool, introduced by Namita Gokhale. Over to you, Namita.
Welcome to you both. बहुत दिल से आप दोनों का यहाँ आमंत्रण. ये sorry, I'm just a bit tired today, but whenever I enter the Darbar Hall, all my tiredness goes away. I tell every single audience the same story, so you may have heard it before, that this is the core of the Jaipur Literature Festival. This is where we began. We never had an audience like this in the first 2 or 3 years. The entire festival audience was 30, 40 people. But this room is the Shakti Sthal, the Vastu, the Feng Shui of this entire festival. And our best speakers, our most intimate audiences are here. So now, as you know, today's session is titled Kashmir Readings. Kashmir is a region of overwhelming beauty, compounded by extraordinary pain and suffering. The ancient literary traditions of Kashmir go back to the Shaivite Sanskrit texts and then to the significant literature within the Buddhist and Vaishnavite traditions. As we move on in time, we cannot forget the poetry of Lal Dev, the unique mystic poetess of Kashmir. The influence of Islam, which permeated from Central Asia, had its own unique rasas. Nand Rishi's work was a blend of Hindu and Islamic influences. Habba Khatun was a famous poetess of the 16th century. We had Arnimal, another magnificent poetess in the 18th century. So women's voices were historically very strong. Also, the writing of Sufi mystic poets like Shamas Fakir, Wahab Khar, Soch Kral, Samad Mir, and Ahad Zarkar are a part of the Kashmiri consciousness. And it's a consciousness where all parts of the community share a literary heritage. Writing in Kashmir includes work in English, Kashmiri, Urdu, Pahari, Dogri, Hindi, so many other strains. From Agha Shahid Ali to Mirza Wahid in English, to an extraordinary range of Urdu and Hindi writing, we have a sweep of plural and secular voices addressing a range of subjects from theater, satire, and comedy to the deeply engaged political writing and conflict literature of recent years. Here in Jaipur, we've had the privilege of hosting over the years many, many Kashmiri writers, including Neerja Mattu, Chandrakanta, Naseem Shefai, Rahul Pandita, Iftikhar Gilani, Basharat Peer. Basharat has been a regular over the years, as has Rahul Pandita, as has Neerja. And then also Anjum Zamrud Habib, and Siddharth Gigoo is coming back again for the second time, and so is Sahil Maqboolji. So I'm delighted and to welcome them both back. Siddharth Gigoo, who was here last in 2012, has studied English literature at JNU and is the author of two well-regarded works of fiction, The Garden of Solitude and A Fistful of Earth and Other Stories. He has also written and directed two short films and co-edited with Varad Sharma his most recent book, Hold It Up Now, the late. Sir, kitab dikhao. A Long Dream of Home. It's a book which says The Long Dream of Home, the persecution, exodus, and exile of Kashmiri Pandits. The book bears testimony to the literature of memory and is a chronicle of the quarter century of bitter exile that the Kashmiri Pandits have faced with fortitude and courage and also with heartbreak. Now to turn to my second guest, Sahil Maqboolji. He first came to JLF in 2012, where he spoke about his book on prison experiences, Shabistan-e-Wajood. His writing, even at its most human and compassionate, reflects the literature of conflict and the harsh situation in Kashmir. His first book was Khamosh Talatum, an Urdu poetry collection in 1991. His third book, Tanaza-e-Kashmir, is a history of Kashmir. His other works include Kadam Kadam Tazir and Parchawa, a collection of Pahari poetry. So now I'm going to, the format is that for I'm going to hand over the stage to Siddharth for 20 minutes. When he finishes, in these 20 minutes, he'll write about the context, the background, the personal inspirations of his work, and also read a little bit. And then we'll hand over to Sahilji, and then we'll have questions addressed to both of them. So, and especially Sahilji has lost his phone, so I think he needs a special clap. And because it's the most depressing thing that can happen when you leave home is to lose your phone. So he has our sympathies, collective JLF sympathies. Siddharth, over to you.
Thank you, Namita. Can you hear me? Am I audible? Thank you for coming. First of all, it's an honor to be here again after 5 years. I was here in 2012, I guess, in which I got to talk about my novel, which had come out in 2011. It's been 5 years, and I was wondering about my, I was reflecting rather about my journey in the last 5 years. In those last 5 years, I wrote a lot of short stories. I made 2 short films based on 2 of my short stories. And I got to travel a lot in Jammu to the camps, to people, to meet people who are still living in camps. Across 3 generations of people, I met them. And I collected their stories. I would go to them and I meet them. And then as a story writer, as a novelist, there were a lot of people who told me, you should write about us also, not the way you want to write about us, but you should give us voice. I'll come to that. But I must, first of all, thank Namita for inviting me again. It's a big day for Namita because it's a birthday today, if I'm not mistaken. Tomorrow, that's fine. Well, it's the last day of the Jaipur Literature Festival. May she do 100 such festivals. So happy birthday in advance, Namita. I spoke briefly in the earlier panel at Patak, in which I talked about my own life, my own journey, growing up in Kashmir and leaving my home in Kashmir, my parents and my grandparents, and then spending 5 years next to a camp for the displaced Kashmiri Pandits. And then I studied in a camp school first, I studied in a camp college later, and then I came out to Delhi, and I did my education in Jawaharlal Nehru University. And then I would go back to Kashmir as a tourist and a pilgrim. I went to Kashmir in 2012 for the second time after leaving my home in 1990. Before 2012, I secretly went to Kashmir in 1996, which was primarily to experience what was happening in Kashmir in 1990. Well, as you know, 90s were the darkest decade in the history of contemporary Kashmir. Kashmir would be in curfew ridden for days and months together. And I went with a friend who said that if you must come, because you're a Kashmiri Pandit, you need to grow a beard. So I grew a beard for 2-3 months, and it was, so I was going in disguise. I studied, I lived there with a friend's place, and I ventured out in the evenings when the curfew was relaxed, and I saw Kashmir had been transformed into a war zone. Those 3 days I was imprisoned in my friend's place. I wanted to go to my ancestral house in downtown Srinagar. I was advised not to do that, because downtown, I was told, was a liberated zone. Liberated as in, people said that, you know, it's almost Pakistan. That's what we wanted it to become. Then, In 2012, I got to go to my old house, and I had a very interesting experience there when I met people who were living inside the house, and they welcomed me and they said that, you know, have you come to buy this house from us? I said, no, I've not come, I've just come to see it once, perhaps for a very emotional, sentimental reason. I spent a few hours inside the house, and as I left, I was in the street, and there's this woman who stood next to me. She said, do you recognize me? I said, I'm sorry, I don't recognize you. She must have been in her mid-40s that time. She said, look at me very closely. Give you a minute, 2 minutes, think, do you recognize me? I was so ashamed of myself. I'm sorry, I don't recognize you at all, so you got to forgive me for that. And then she said, I will give you 5 more minutes. And she was talking in Kashmiri, and her tone changed. I said, I'm sorry, I am not able to place you. Then she just slapped me hard, and I was just shaken a bit. And I tried to gather myself, and I saw tears in her eyes. She broke down. She said, and she gave me a gali, in Kashmiri gali. She said, you know, you were this small when you were born. You know, I've held you in my arms, and your mother was like my sister, and I almost first adopted you, and then I was going to kidnap you because I would tell your mother that, you know, I'm going to take this kid of yours. She said, do you remember my name? I said, sorry, I can't recall your name. And then she told me who she was. She was our neighbor. And she asked me about my grandparents, about my parents. My grandfather was dead that time. My grandmother was alive. So I said, you know, they live in Jammu now. And this is the first time I'm coming here. It's been 18 years. So she said, you know, this, you must stay here for some time. You know, I won't let you go. So I said, next time I will definitely come. And then, as I was leaving that locality, which is downtown Srinagar, I called my father. I said that, look, I'm here. He said he just told my grandmother that Siddharth is in Kashmir, and she wants to talk to you. She called me. I mean, she. My father gave the phone to her, and she said, I heard that you are home. So she said it in Kashmiri. I heard you are home. So I was struck by the irony of it, you know. After 18 years, I mean, we were settled, not comfortably. We were resigned to the idea of living in Jammu because we had, you know, been from one house, rented house, to another. I had spent a year in a dormitory in a camp. And then I said, yeah, you still call this place home? She said, yeah, certainly. Of course, this conversation was Kashmiri, and you know, there are certain elements which are getting lost in that. So it remained with me for a year that she was still calling this place home, although we had sold the house and it had passed from one owner to another. Then in 2013, in July, my parents thought that they should, because she was ill and she was in her 80s, they thought that we should take her to Kashmir. And one of the reasons was to take her to her old house in downtown Srinagar. And they did one day. And they went by road to Kashmir, and they stayed in a rented accommodation. The purpose was to spend 15, 20 days there. But in the evening, she fell sick, and she was wheeled into a nearby clinic where she was attended to by doctors, and they said that, look, we have examined her. She seems to be in a very critical state. and we can't handle it, so you better take her to the SMHS hospital in Karanagar. My father called me. He said, look, this happened. She is, it seems, not doing well, and we are trying to figure out what to do. I said, I'll book my tickets, and I booked my air tickets. I was, the next day, my flight was booked. And then in the night, my dad said that the doctors say she may not survive because her intestines are a mess. And one of the doctors is suggesting surgery. But, you know, they're saying that she may not survive the surgery. There are 90% chances that she may die on the operating table. So I got very anxious, and I flew down next day, next morning. And so my dad said that, should we go for surgery or should we just let her? And then I said, fine, you take the call. It's a very difficult decision. Then I reached Srinagar in the morning. The previous day, one of the shrines had been burnt, and there was violence in the city, and curfew had been imposed. And when I landed at the airport, the taxi union said, you can't go into the city, Srinagar, because it's curfew, we can't go. So I was very worried, and for half an hour I was loitering and trying to beg, plead with anybody who could take me. The only vehicles which were going into Srinagar town, city, were people who had the curfew pass, and I did not have. So there was one gentleman who walked up to me. He was a taxi driver. He said, what is the matter? You seem worried. I said, yeah, this is the case. So I explained the position to him, and he said, let me drive you to the hospital. So we reached the hospital, and I was climbing the stairs. There was a delay because I had got to wait. And my father's uncle was there, and he said, you need to rush because she's sinking. She's sinking. And I rushed. I ran. The matron came out, and my father's uncle introduced me to the matron. Says, her grandson is here. Is she alive? The matron said, she just passed away. So that was a very terrible moment. So I'll stop now, because these are some of the life stories, experiences which one has gone through, which has shaped me as a writer, as a storyteller. Yes, a little. So I must request. Okay, I have time. Okay, see, this is another book which came out last year. It's called A Fistful of Earth and Other Stories. Bunch of 16 stories. So I will read a few passages from this story. I'll read randomly, you know, because randomness defines us. Okay. Maybe a few stories. It was during a visit to the library at the Museum of the Disappearing Clans that I first stumbled upon the incomplete correspondences between a man and a woman of whom I had heard little during the early days of my interest in the history and biographies of the expelled people. In the beginning, I couldn't make much sense of those letters, which had been stacked in a closet at the museum for years. Without further delay, I set out to explore the hidden secrets in the fantastic exchange between the two strangers who, I realized later, share an inexplicable and inseparable bond with each other. From the letters, it seemed that the man was in his mid-40s. There was no way to know his exact age. But later, after several readings of the letters, it appeared to me that he might have been over 50. The two had met one morning at what I imagined to be a deserted cul-de-sac and parted after a long conversation, promising to meet again the next day. I comforted myself with the idea that figuring out their ages wasn't important. It was better to proceed further towards a deeper understanding and appreciation of their intricate relationship. From the incomplete letters, it was unclear who they were and what became of them. These banished people, my initial study revealed, were forsaken by their own progeny, who were scattered in faraway places. The descendants of these banished people diminished year after year, unable to beget any children. A report prepared by my predecessor suggested that there were only 11 original specimens left in the entire world, and they now belong to a secret society unknown to most. These 11 were kept at an undisclosed location where they lived in captivity, away from the civilized world. No one in the outside world knew what food they were fed, what clothing they were made to wear, what aspirations they were allowed to express. How many of them were men and how many were women? These questions remained a mystery, a guarded secret. For the outsiders, these 11 didn't exist. All right, I'll stop here and I will give the microphone to my friend.
To come back now to my friend, to Siddharth's friend, Sahil Maqbool, ye Hindi mein bhi bolenge, Angrezi mein bhi, Urdu mein bhi, Pahadi mein bhi. Aur Pahadi ke liye, I have a special joy because I'm also a Kumaoni. Of course, the Pahadi of Kashmir is different from our Pahadi, but it's still Himalayan dialect. And go ahead, do some readings, do some this thing, and then we'll have both of you, okay, if you have any comments to each other or anything.
Okay. Shukriya, Didi, Namita ji, aur Ila Arun ji, aapka bahut bahut shukriya. Aapko maine kal kaha aap aaye, aur pichle session mein bhi aap the. The reason is that I mostly write in Urdu. So Urdu Hindustani, mujhe lagta hai, everybody will understand here. Kyunki agar main Urdu mein likh ke Angrezi mein baat karunga apne literature ke bare mein, to I mean, ji haan. To baat ye hai ki Siddharth ji ne to sari kahani batai, aur Siddharth ji ke saath baith ke mujhe lagta hai ki mera wo gulshan, mera wo chaman jo ek rang se Kashmir mein khali mujhe nazar aata tha, वो यहाँ आके इस स्टेज पे मुकम्मल हुआ. ये हमारी सोसाइटी का एक बहुत ही खूबसूरत रंग, हमारी सोसाइटी का एक बहुत ही डेजलिंग एंड शाइनिंग फ्लावर ऑफ आवर सोसाइटी. कहते हैं ना कि चमन में इख्तलाते रंगबू से बात बनती है, तुम ही तुम हो तो क्या तुम हो, हम ही हम हैं तो क्या हम हैं. और यहाँ हम इकट्ठे बैठे हैं आज और मुझे बहुत अच्छा लग रहा है. कहानी हम कश्मीरियों की तकरीबन सबकी एक जैसी है. एक ऐसा वक्त जब एक आग लगे किसी इलाके में, या सैलाब आ जाए किसी इलाके में, या तूफान आ जाए किसी इलाके में, तो ये सारी कुदरती आफतें किसी का नाम पता एड्रेस उसका रिलीजन उसका फेथ पूछ के नहीं आती. हर कोई इसे इफेक्टेड हो जाता है और हर किसी के दिल पे चोटें लगती हैं. हर किसी का घर बह जाता है, जल जाता है, गिर जाता है, किसी की जान जाती है, किसी का घर जाता है, किसी के माल मवेशी जाते हैं और किसी की खेती उजड़ जाती है. तो हम भी उस ऐसी जगह पर रह रहे थे जहाँ पे एक ऐसा तूफान आया, हम सब के दिलों पर चोटें लगी हुई है. वी आर ऑल हर्ट. किसी बहुत बड़े आर्टिस्ट ने कहा था कि जो हाथ से बनाई हुई पेंटिंग है, द हैंडमेड पेंटिंग, डोंट गो क्लोजर टू इट, यू विल फाइंड द स्क्रैचेस ऑफ ब्रश ऑन इट. Watch it from a distance, you will find it beautiful. But हम एक ऐसी पेंटिंग है कश्मीर की सोसाइटी. हमें नज़दीक से आके देखिए कि कितने ब्रशेस की स्क्रैचेस हमारे ऊपर है. अगर सिद्धार्थ जी अपने घर से चले गए और इनको बहुत सारी मुश्किलें उठानी पड़ी, घर चला गया, बहुत सारे लोगों की जाने भी गईं, लेकिन मैंने 4 साल जेल में गुजारे और 4 साल में मेरी फैमिली सफ़र करती रही और उनको किसी ने नहीं पूछा 4 साल तक मेरे बच्चे स्कूल कैसे गए, मेरे घर में कैसे सब चलता रहा गुजारा. और ये हम एग्जाम्पल हैं एक सोसाइटी की कि किसी ना किसी तरीके से हम हर जगह मुतासर हुए हैं. और अब हमें इस सोसाइटी में कौन सी चीज़ है जो मुतासर करती है, जो प्रवोक करती है हमें लिखने पे, मैं उसका एक छोटा सा खाका पेश करना चाहूँगा, स्मॉल स्केच. जब मैं रोज़ अपनी ज़िंदगी का स्टार्ट करता हूँ तो मुझे ऐसे लगता है कि एक तरफ एक लड़की है नसरीन नाम की, जो मुसलमान लड़की है, समझ लीजिए वो मेरी कहानी की हीरोइन है. और दूसरी तरफ मेरे मकान में रहने वाली उर्मिला नामी एक पंडित लड़की है, जो मेरे रास्ते देखती रहती है कि मेरा भाई कब आए और मैं उसके बाजू पर राखी बांधूं, उसको देखूं. उसकी माँ रोज़ मुझे उर्मिला के साथ चाय पिलाती है, खाना खिलाती है, सुबह बुलाती है, दुकान पर भेजती है. उनके बाप जो पंडित जी हैं, प्रेमी जी हैं, वो मुझे सबक पढ़ाते हैं. और सच्ची बात यह है कि मैंने मोस्ट ऑफ माय लेसंस इन पर्शियन फारसी जुबान के मोस्ट ऑफ माय लेसंस आई हैव गॉट फ्रॉम ए पंडित जी टीचर सर्वानंद कौल प्रेमी द ग्रेट स्कॉलर ऑफ कश्मीर. और अगर मैंने किसी लड़की के साथ सबसे पहले दोस्ती की तो वो भी उर्मिला पंडित थी, जो एक पंडित लड़की थी. एक हाजी साहब हैं हमारी स्टोरी में जो पूरे गांव के मुखिया हैं, परेशान रहते हैं हर वक्त. और उस तरह एक सरदार जी हैं जो हमारे पड़ोस में हैं, और वो भी आके जो है शाम को काका और सरदार जी और हाजी साहब इकट्ठे बैठते हैं, बातें करते हैं. उसके बाद पद्मश्री नाम की एक और लेडी है जो हिंदू लेडी है, जिसने मुझे अपनी माँ ने तब खाना नहीं खिलाया था जब उसने मुझे खाना खिलाया था, और वो भी मुझसे काम लेती है जैसे वो अपने बेटे से काम लेती है, और उसको भी मेरा रास्ता जो है देखती रहती है. जैतून बेगम नाम की एक मुस्लिम लड़की है जो खिड़की से मुझे झांकती है, मुझे छेड़ती रहती है, मुझे परेशान करती रहती है और अट्रैक्ट करती रहती है, हालांकि मेरा जो ध्यान है वो नसरीन की तरफ है. तो इस तरह से एक प्यार मोहब्बत भरा माहौल है. लेकिन फिर क्या होता है, सडनली कुछ अनजान चेहरे सामने आ जाते एकदम, जिनका उस जमीन के साथ कोई ताल्लुक ही नहीं है. कुछ जाने कुछ अनजाने, कुछ हिंदुस्तान की कुछ रियासतों से आए हुए लगते हैं और कुछ पाकिस्तान की तरफ से आए हुए लगते हैं. कुछ के हाथों में हथियार है और कुछ के मुंह पर पट्टियां बंधी हुई हैं और धंधनाते हुए चल रहे हैं मेरी जमीनों में से. कुछ रास्तों में पकड़ के मुझे मेरी जेबें टटोलते हैं, गाड़ी से उतार कर मेरी आइडेंटिफिकेशन परेड्स कराते हैं, और कुछ रातों को दरवाजे तोड़ के घरों में घुस जाते हैं, धराते हैं, धमकाते हैं, और उनकी लाइन टो करने की जो है मुझे उसके लिए वो परेशान करते हैं. तो इस तरह से दो तरफा, फिर चार तरफा, आठ तरफा खौफ है, परेशानी है, ये माहौल है. और इस माहौल में मैं कभी डर जाता हूँ, कभी भागने की कोशिश करता हूँ, और कभी गुस्सा भी आता है और मारने या मर जाने के लिए भी अपने दिमाग में सोचता हूँ. गोमगो और कश्मकश का यही आलम है. रात गुजरती है, ख्वाब टूटता है, घर में रोशनी दाखिल होती है, एक नए दिन का आगाज होता है. घर से निकलकर अपने अहले खाना से ये कह के रुख्सत लेता हूँ कि शाम तक जिंदा रहा तो फिर मिलूंगा. और जब इस तरह का माहौल जब मुझे मुतासिर करता है तो फिर एक राइटर की हैसियत से जब मैं पोइट बन जाता हूँ कभी कभी, तो मेरे कलम से कुछ इस तरह की बात जो है सामने आती है. एक मशवरा है, नज़म का नाम है मशवरा. संग बाजू के शहर में संगबाज स्टोन पेल्टर, संग बाजू के शहर में दिल की गलियों में न जा, संग बाजू के शहर में दिल की गलियों में न जा, संग बाजी के अंदेशे कूचा कूचा जा बजा, लब कुशाई सर उठाना, लब कुशाई सर उठाना, खुल के हंसना मुस्कुराना, और इजहार मोहब्बत इस शहर में है गुना. कोई गारंटी नहीं, मुझे अपनी अपने आप की कोई गारंटी नहीं होती है. और फिर जहलम नदी जब मेरे सामने आती है, जो बहुत इंशेंट और बहुत पवित्र नदी कश्मीर में मानी जाती है, हमारा कश्मीर में अपना पुराण जो है जिसको नीलमत पुराण कहते हैं. आई होप सिद्धार्थ हैज रेड इट. आई हैव रेड इट इन उर्दू एंड कश्मीरी वर्जन, ट्रांसलेटेड बाय ग्रेट पंडित स्कॉलर पंडित मोतीलाल साकी. एंड उस नदी पर जब मैं बैठता हूँ जाके, तो मुझे कुछ इस तरह का माहौल नजर आता है कि गहरी खामोशी का आलम, काली लंबी रात सी है, हर एक लब पे हर एक दिल में आके रुकी एक बात सी है, सुर्ख चनारों के पत्तों पर खूने जिगर का वहम गुमा, दिल के खंडर से उठता है हल्का हल्का एक धुआं, गदला पानी जहलिम का, मडी वाटर ऑफ जहलिम, गदला पानी जहलिम का, और वीरानी गुलजारों की सहमी सहमी हर एक हस्ती, खामोशी में एक फुगा, मेरे अरमानों की धरती करिया करिया जख्मी जख्मी, आंचल में पैवंद हजारों, कूचा कूचा मौत के साए, गली गली मातम का समा, मेरी जन्नत के बाशंदे जैसे मजमाए नूह गरा. مجمعِ نوح گراں کہتے ہیں ہم, جو محرم کے دنوں میں جلوس نکلتا ہے جو وہ بین کر رہے ہوتے ہیں اس کو بولتے ہیں. تو مجھے لگتا ہے کہ میری جو ساری بستی ہے وہاں کے لوگ سارے ماتم کناں ہو گئے ہیں, وہ محرم کے جلوس میں چل رہے ہیں اپنا سینہ پیٹتے ہوئے. تو یہ ہے کیونکہ کسی گھر سے بیٹا چلا گیا, کسی سے بیٹی چلی گئی, کسی کا رشتہ دار چلا گیا اور کسی کا ہونے والا رشتہ دار چلا گیا. کوئی گھر ایسا نہیں ہے, کوئی ڈالی ایسی نہیں ہے جہاں پہ اس ہوا نے افیکٹ نہ کیا ہو. یہ تو پوئٹری کی بات ہوتی ہے, لیکن جب ہم نثر لکھتے ہیں, جب فکشن لکھتے ہیں, تو وہاں بھی یہ چیزیں ہمارا پیچھا نہیں چھوڑتی ہیں. میری جو کلیکشن ہے ابھی تک شارٹ سٹوریز کی, جو کلیکشن آئی ہے قدم قدم تعزیر کے نام سے, قدم قدم تعزیر مینس پنشمنٹ ایٹ ایوری سٹیپ, ایوری سٹیپ. اور کیسے وہ ہم پنش ہوتے ہیں ہر سٹیپ پہ, ایک اس میں سٹوری ہے, شارٹ سٹوری. ایلا جی شاید کسی فلم کے لیے آپ کو وہ اس کا بیس مل جائے, شادی شیرین کی. شادی شیرین ایک لڑکی ہے, اس کی شادی ہے, یہ افسانے کا نام ہے. اس کا ایک ایکسٹریکٹ سناتا ہوں. میاں بیوی بات کر رہے ہیں آپس میں, یہ دونوں ملک ہندوستان اور پاکستان دھیرے دھیرے ایک دوسرے کے قریب آ رہے ہیں. یو مسٹ ہیو ہرڈ وین دا روڈز ویئر اوپن بٹوین انڈیا اینڈ پاکستان فار ٹریڈ تھرو کشمیر, یہ ان دنوں کا میں نے لکھا ہے. یہ دونوں ملک ہندوستان اور پاکستان دھیرے دھیرے ایک دوسرے کے نزدیک آ رہے ہیں, سرحدیں کھل رہی ہیں اور لوگ ادھر ادھر آ جا رہے ہیں. کشمیری لیڈر جو کل تک پاکستان کے ساتھ الحاق اور آزادی کی باتیں کر رہے تھے, آج دونوں ملکوں کے چہیتے بنے ہوئے ہیں اور جوتیوں میں دال بانٹ رہے ہیں, امن و امان کی باتیں کر رہے ہیں, عوام کے ساتھ کیے ہوئے وعدے پورے کرنے کی باتیں کر رہے ہیں. کبھی انہی لوگوں نے ہمارے نوجوانوں کو بندوق اٹھانے کے لیے کہا تھا, سبز رومال دکھا کر عوام کو بہلایا تھا, کبھی پاکستانی نمک دکھا کر, کبھی ہندو مسلم سکھ اتحاد کے نعرے لگا کر, اور کبھی نظام مصطفیٰ کا دھوکہ دے کر. کچھ لوگ ہندوستان زندہ باد کہتے ہیں, کچھ لوگ پاکستان, اور کچھ لوگ خود مختار ریاست کا نعرہ بلند کرتے ہیں. جتنے لیڈر ہیں اتنے فارمولے, جتنی پارٹیاں اتنے پروگرام, پوری قوم کا ستیاناس کر کے رکھ دیا ہے ان لوگوں نے. یہ ایک سٹوری کا ایکسٹریکٹ بنتا ہے. اب جیسے میرے بھائی سدھارتھ صاحب نے اپنی کمیونٹی کے بارے میں بات کی, حالانکہ میری کمیونٹی کے بارے میں بات کی کہ پنڈت وہاں سے نکلے, یہ پھر ہندوستان کی مختلف ریاستوں میں آئے, انہوں نے بڑی پریشانیاں اٹھائیں, دے آر آل دا وے دے ہیو بین سفرنگ فار لاسٹ 25 years, اینڈ وی فیل دیٹ پین سٹنگ بیک ان دا کشمیر. ہماری ساری سمپتھیز اس کے ساتھ ہیں. دیر آر سم پولیٹیکل ریزنز کہ کیوں نہیں یہ پرابلم سالو ہو رہی ہے, اس کے ساتھ بہت سارے لوگ جو ہے وہ انوالو ہو چکے ہیں. لیکن اسی ایک پکچر کا ایک دوسرا رخ بھی ہے, کیونکہ جب ٹینشن شروع ہوا تو پنڈت برادری جو تھی وہ ہندوستان کی طرف بھاگی, لیکن وہ لوگ جن جو بارڈرز پہ رہتے تھے, جب آرمی نے بارڈرز پہ کور کر لیا آرمی, تو ان لوگوں کے لیے وہاں زندہ رہنا مشکل ہو گیا. انہوں نے مائگریشن کی اور وہ مظفر آباد کی طرف چلے گئے, پار پاکستان چلے گئے, بارڈر توڑ کے پار چلے گئے. اینڈ لکیلی آئی وزٹڈ پاکستان ان 2001 آن پاسپورٹ, آئی واز الانگ ود اے ڈیلیگیشن ایز اے جرنلسٹ, بیکاز پروفیشنلی آئی ایم اے جرنلسٹ. وہاں میں ان لوگوں سے ملا اور وہی لوگ میں نے لاہور ایئرپورٹ پر دیکھے ہمارے وفد کا ویلکم کرنے کے لیے آئے ہوئے, انہی لوگوں کو میں نے اسلام آباد میں بھی دیکھا, اینڈ دین آئی ریچڈ ان مظفر آباد, آئی فاؤنڈ دی سیم پیپل دیئر. میں نے کسی سے پوچھا, میں نے کہا یہ کیا ہے, بولا یار یہ ان کو مائگریشن کی قیمت ادا کرنی پڑتی ہے. جب بھی کشمیر کا کوئی ڈیلیگیشن آتا ہے تو یہاں کی جو گورنمنٹ ہے وہ ان کو لا کے یوز کرتی ہے اور ان کو وہ کرواتی ہے, نعرے شعرے لگواتی ہے, اور اس کے عوض میں ان کو بعد میں وہاں کھانا ملتا ہے, جگہ ملتی ہے, اکوموڈیشن ملتی ہے وغیرہ ہوتا ہے. تو میں نے وہاں پر ایک شارٹ سٹوری لکھی تھی سرحد کے اس پار, تو اس کا ایک ایکسٹریکٹ دیکھیے آپ. مظفر آباد, راجہ مظفر خان بمبا کا بسایا ہوا شہر, آج سے ڈیڑھ دہائی قبل کوئی شہر نہیں تھا. کشمیر کی بدلی ہوئی سیاسی صورتحال کی وجہ سے توجہ کا مرکز بنا اور دیکھتے ہی دیکھتے وہاں تعمیر و ترقی کا تیز رفتار دور شروع ہوا. میری نظر جدھر جاتی مجھے اپنے وطن کشمیر کے لوگ نظر آتے, کوئی مہاجر, کوئی مجاہد, کوئی لیڈر, کوئی مزدور. کتنے ہی کشمیری نوجوان بندوق لانے کی غرض سے سرحد پار گئے لیکن یہاں سے واپس نہ آنے کا ارادہ کر لیا. کچھ نوکری کی کر کے وہیں بس گئے اور کچھ نے شادیاں کر لیں. مہاجر کیمپوں اور تنظیموں کے دفتروں میں بکھرے ہوئے میرے وطن کے انمول موتی, آنے والے وقت کے مہاراجے مہاراجہ جائے اور لیڈر گلی گلی مارے مارے پھر رہے ہیں, دو ملکوں کی سیاستیں دنیا کی حالت اور دنیا کی ذہین ترین قوم کے سرمایے کو در بدر کا بھکاری بنا ڈالا ہے اور حالات سدھرنے کا انتظار کر رہے ہیں. ادھر دوسری طرف میری جنت ارضی سے ہجرت کرنے والے کشمیری پنڈت بھائیوں کا حال مختلف تھا. اگرچہ تنگ دستی اور غریب و دیاری نے انہیں بھی توڑ پھوڑ کر رکھ دیا تھا لیکن انہیں احسانوں کی قیمت نہیں چکانی پڑ رہی تھی. وہ لوگ دریاؤں کے پانی کی طرح آپس میں گھل مل گئے تھے لیکن دوسری طرف کا حال مختلف تھا. دمیل پل پر بار بار مجھے اسی بات پر افسوس ہو رہا تھا. شاید انسانوں اور دریاؤں کے پانی میں یہی فرق ہوتا ہے. پانی کچھ دیر چلنے کے بعد ایک دوسرے میں گھل مل جاتے ہیں لیکن انسان دور دور تک چلنے کے بعد بھی الگ الگ رہتے ہیں, کراچی اور مظفر آباد کے مہاجروں کی طرح. یو مسٹ ہیو سین ٹو ریورس میٹنگ سم ویئر, جہاں سنگم ہوتا ہے. ایک دریا ایک طرف سے آتا ہے, دوسرا دوسری طرف سے, اور دونوں کے رنگ الگ ہوتے ہیں. تو کافی دیر تک چلتے چلتے یہ دونوں الگ رہتے ہیں لیکن ایک وقت آتا ہے جب یہ دونوں مل جاتے ہیں. تو یہی چیز میں یہاں ڈسکس کر رہا ہوں کہ یہاں کے لوگ جو ہمارے پنڈت بھائی تھے وہ ان دو دریاؤں کی طرح مل گئے, لیکن وہاں جو ہمارے چلے گئے تھے لوگ وہ آج بھی مہاجر ہیں, آج بھی ان کو مہاجر کہہ کے بلایا جاتا ہے.
تو ابھی ایسا کرتے ہیں, آپ کی ریڈنگ سب ہو گئی نا,
جی جی,
تو کیونکہ آئی تھنک اتنی آڈینس اتسک ہے کہ آپ سے کچھ سوال پوچھیں, کچھ بات چیت ہو. اور میں یہ چاہتی ہوں کیونکہ آپ لوگ جیسے آپ نے کہا اتنی دوریاں بن گئی ہیں سب کے بیچ میں, آپ دونوں بھی ایک دوسروں سے اگر ایک دو سوال ہوں کریے, بات چیت کریے, کانورسیشن کریے. پر پہلے ذرا آڈینس سے لے لیتے ہیں. واٹ ڈو یو فیل سدھارتھ, وڈ یو رادر آسک ایچ ادر ون اور ٹو کوئسچنز کہ آپ
سرٹنلی آئی تھنک وی شوڈ انگیج
فرسٹ ود دی آڈینس. پر ہاں, پر مجھے ذرا اردو کی تو سن لی وائس, انگریزی کی ذرا کشمیری کی بھی سننی ہے.
میں پہاڑی میں بھی تھوڑا بول
رہا ہوں. ہاں, تو آپ کچھ کشمیری میں اور آپ کچھ پہاڑی میں بولیے. چاہے اب ابھی بھول گئے کشمیری.
See, first of all, I met him yesterday at the author's lounge for the first time. Of course, we had heard of each other and we instantly recognized each other and we comforted each other that, you know, we are going to be in the panel. So we almost hugged and he said, meko phone hi chori, my phone was lost. So I instantly asked, acha garu karu tai phone, did you call home? Then he was saying, we were trying to find the phone. Then within 5 minutes of the conversation, we inevitably, you know, as if we were not strangers at all. And I had of course googled him and found about him and a little bit read about his, and the conversation began from the 6th century and onwards, you know, the way we talked. And within 15 minutes we had traversed the entire history of Kashmir. And then we said, look, let's say something tomorrow that we should talk about integration and not segregation. We should steer clear of the rhetoric which typically you hear on the news hour debates. It's a frequent refrain. Everybody talks about the same thing. There is bitterness and hate. Forget about that. That will remain. But what now?
So this is the bridge of literature we are talking about today.
Yes.
And it's been very good to see you. Let's get some audience questions, just a few, then a few from them. So I can see a lot of hands rising. We'll begin here. Aage peeche sab ho jayega. Please introduce yourself, get up so the audience knows who's speaking.
She doesn't need to be introduced.
No, but she needs introduced because they...
Ji, main Ilaru hoon. اور ساحل صاحب اور جگلو صاحب دونوں صاحب کو میں بہت بہت آپ کا ویلکم کرتی ہوں. یہ اس کو اتفاق ہی کہیں گے کیونکہ سیشن چھوٹا ہے, اور آج آپ دونوں جنے یہاں بیٹھے ہیں. آپ نے ایک بات کہی, وہ میرا ایک تھوڑا سا وہ ہے کہ آپ نے کہا یہ گھل مل گئے. باہر کے ملک میں محتاج ہونا تو کسی کی ویوشتا ہے, کسی کی مجبوری ہے. اپنے ملک میں محتاج ہونا, یہ گھل مل نہیں گئے ہیں. یہ اگر جموں میں بھی ہیں تو ان کو لوگ بے چارگی سے نگاہ سے دیکھتے ہیں. اگر یہ بامبے میں بھی ہیں, اگر یہ دلی میں بھی ہیں, تو مقصد یہ ہے کہ آپ دونوں جنوں کا درد ایک ہی ہے. اور اب مسئلہ, جیسے آپ نے کہا, اب کیا؟ کیونکہ جیسے آپ کہتے ہیں کہ پنڈت جو تھے وہ آپ کے ٹیچر پنڈت رہے ہیں, اور بہت انٹلیکٹ جو تھا پنڈتوں کا تھا, ہے نا, تو ایک حصہ آپ کا چلا گیا. کیونکہ میں آپ کی زبان میں ہی لکھتی پڑھتی ہوں تو آپ کی زبان مجھے زیادہ سمجھ میں آئی. آپ سے میں اتفاق زیادہ کرتی ہوں, وہ انگلش میں کر رہے تھے. پر درد اگر ایک سا ہے تو کوششیں क्यों नहीं आप लोग कर रहे कि वापस वापस एक साथ रह के, जहाँ आप कह रहे कि गुल में एक रंग, एक ही रंग दिखता है। इंसिडेंटली मैंने एक नाटक लिखा है जिसका नाम है पीरगनी, जो आपके नज़रिए से है। एहसास का होना बहुत ज़रूरी है, और दूसरा है छोटा कश्मीर जो आपके से। और आज इत्तिफाकन एक लड़का यहाँ बैठा है जो मैं सबको दिखाना चाहूँगी, जो पंडितों और मुसलमान का लड़का है और यहाँ जयपुर में रह रहा है। इसका नाम है करण अली काक। Wow. और कहानी ऐसी।
एला जी बहुत शुक्रिया, आपने बहुत अच्छी तरफ तवज्जा हमारी मोड़ी। देखें, सो फार एज द सोसाइटी इज कंसर्न, सो फार एज द कश्मीर मुस्लिम कम्युनिटी इज कंसर्न, वी हैव ऑलवेज बीन इनवाइटिंग आवर ब्रदर्स आवर सिस्टर्स बैक टू कश्मीर। इस वक्त भी वहाँ पे जो एक लॉट निकल गई शुरू में, लेकिन जो कुछ लोग वहाँ रह गए, जिन इलाकों का जिक्र सिद्धार्थ जी ने किया कि देवेर he was told that they were liberated areas, there was no liberated as such area, लेकिन बाहर से जब कोई बंदा आता था तो वहाँ का कोई कॉमन लोकल में बोल देता था कि यार इधर नहीं जाना। एक सन टीवी का एक कॉरेस्पॉन्डेंट आया वहाँ पे मेरे पास, और मुझे दिल्ली से मेरी एक बहन है आशा खोसा, वेरी रिनोन जर्नलिस्ट, उन्होंने बोला मेरा भाई वहाँ है, वो आपको असिस्ट करेगा पिछले इलेक्शन में। तो वो आते ही मुझे बोला, उसका वो जो कॉरेस्पॉन्डेंट था, ही वॉज अ साउथ इंडियन पर्सन, मैं उसका नाम भूल गया, बोला देखो यार हमें डाउनटाउन नहीं ले जाना। मैंने कहा डाउनटाउन में क्या है? बोला यार मैंने सुना वहाँ बहुत कुछ गड़बड़ है। नेक्स्ट डे व्हेन इलेक्शन यू नो वोटिंग स्टार्टेड, तो आई टुक हिम टू डाउनटाउन विदाउट टेलिंग एनीथिंग। मैं ले गया उसको नवहट्टा में, जामा मस्जिद है, सिद्धार्थ जी जानते हैं, बहुत पुरानी जामा मस्जिद है, 600-700 साल पुरानी, और वहाँ पे वो शूटिंग कर रहा है। ही फाउंड अ वेरी ह्यूज मॉन्यूमेंट लाइक जामा मस्जिद ऑफ दिल्ली, एंड ही वाज इंटरेस्टिंगली शूटिंग अलॉन्ग विद हिज टीम। आफ्टर फिनिशिंग हिज शूटिंग आफ्टर 20 मिनट्स ही सेड व्हिच एरिया इज दिस, आई सेड दिस इज डाउनटाउन, ही सेड ओह माय गॉड दिस इज डाउनटाउन लेट अस मूव। मैंने कहा क्या हुआ? कहा मुझे, मैंने कहा था डाउनटाउन में। मैंने कहा भाई यहाँ कोई शेर रीछ हमने नहीं पा रखे हैं, लोग घरों में रहते हैं, कोई मसला नहीं होने वाला। तो दो दिन के बाद उसने कहा यार जो मैंने सुना था, जो मुझे बताया गया था, इट वाज ऑल फॉल्स। नाउ द प्रॉब्लम इज कि दोनों तरफ इस मामले में पॉलिटिक्स इन्वॉल्व हो चुकी, देर आर सर्टेन एलिमेंट्स ऑन द बोथ एंड्स, इवन इन द कश्मीर इन द मुस्लिम एंड एंड अनदर साइड इन इंडिया ऑन द पंडित एंड, हु वांट टू यूज बोथ ऑफ अस एज देयर सेलिंग पॉलिटिकल कमोडिटीज, मे बी दे हैव इंटरेस्ट्स, बट as a Muslim, as a member of majority community in Kashmir, my heart, my home, my land is open for these people, and we are at their way. Hum inka rasta dekh rahe hain, hum inko bada miss karte hain, hamare dil mein inke liye bahut zabardast mohabbat hai, aur hum nahi chahte ki ye hamara khoobsurat rang, hamari ye intellectual community aisi jagahon pe rahe jahan mausam inki tabiyat ke mutabik nahi hai.
See, it's this such instances of deep compassion and humanity on both sides, I think, because of which Kashmir has survived this war. I think, I mean, the way I think about it, to be maybe an old-fashioned way of thinking, Kashmir has been the land of the Sufis and Rishis, there has been, Muslims and Pandits have shared a very complicated relationship, very difficult to, you know, be rationalize it and define it in strict terms. There has been bitterness and hate and jealousy at a collective level, but you see instances of friendship, abiding friendships in the current day and age of social media. There are so many Kashmir forums on Facebook and Twitter, and people debate and engage and endlessly. That's called the Kashmir Darbar, which is like Kashmiri, you know, we will just chat and gossip and share, and you know, we will dig the same graves all over again. And but it's not like other regions of the world where you see that hatred and bitterness which is not reversible. And here there are instances wherein there are, especially the younger generation. I met some Kashmiri Muslims recently. They told me that, look, we've gotten to know about you through some of your writings and these books, and now we were told that once Kashmiri Pandits lived here, you know. So look what it does to a community, you know. You already spoken of in the past tense. Once upon a time in this land of Kashmir, there was a sect called Kashmiri Pandits who lived here. But now there's greater awareness about the fact that, you know, these are places in which Kashmiri Pandits lived, and, you know, we must, people have called off the Pakistan bluff, if I may, you know, if I may, Pakistan bluff and that thing. So, and there's disillusionment among both sections of the communities, and especially the younger generation, I think, is full of hope, you know, despite the mistrust and bitterness and suspicion, a sense of suspicion. And the need to rise above the divides. Despite the divides, we will live with, but we will work towards some sort of reconciliation. And perhaps at an individual level, we will work towards this homecoming. Only time will tell.
Okay, next.
मेरा सवाल कश्मीरी पंडितों से ही ताल्लुक रखता है. अभी मकबूल साहब ने भी ये कहा कि आवाम को इस्तेमाल किया जाता है काफ़ी हद तक अपना कोई एक पॉलिटिकल एजेंडा उसको फर्दर करने के लिए. तो बहुत लोगों ने ये बात रखी है, इस बात को कोई नहीं नकार सकता कि कश्मीरी पंडितों ने बहुत दहशत, बहुत जुल्म, बहुत कैफियत झेली है. बट मैनी पीपल इंक्लूडिंग नताशा कॉल, इफ यू रेड दैट वन पीस ऑफ हर्स वेयर शी सेज दैट the this issue of the Kashmiri Pandits, which is a very emotive issue, is used as a smoke screen in certain situations. Aaj Ashok Vajpayee ji intolerance pe baat kare to kisi ne kaha aapne tab kyun nahi award lautaye jab Kashmiri Pandit jo hai unko nikala gaya tha apne gharon se. So it's used as a diversionary tactic in many situations by maybe the Hindu far right, if you may call them that. So she also goes ahead and says that it is the responsibility of those pandits to stand up and say no, not in my name. So, do you agree with this? Do you think that it is the responsibility of a Kashmiri Pandit to stand up and say, no, you will not do this in my name?
Is that for me?
For both of you. It's for the panel.
If I could also say something here. You know, these in my name-isms also are very painful for everybody because nobody really has the time in their own... this is my reply as a writer, that to say that, okay, don't do this in my name, don't do that in my name, because it only politicizes and confuses things even more and more, is my reaction. That the whole disengagement of some writers to give their complete love, right to give their rewards back, some not to keep their awards. So this is a spiral of even refuting, is my question, but abab boliye.
No, as a writer, nobody represents me, I represent myself, you know. Well, my characters represent me to a large extent, you know, the characters I create. None of the prominent people you get to hear on news about debates or politicians or even activists or other writers, no way, I represent myself. So if I'm able to answer your question, I think that applies to all human beings for that matter, or anybody, you know, to apply to people from Punjab or people from the Northeast.
Sometimes, you know, sometimes communities start something. Ke jaise Musliman community ko wahan kaha jata hai ki inhone ji bandook ka support kiya. Pandit community ka kaha jata hai ki inki leadership ne inko advise kiya ki bhai aap yahan se filhal thodi der ke liye chale jaiye. Baad mein jab ye thoda situation theek hogi aur wapas aa jaiye. Maybe two communities decided something, but sooner or later, jaise jaise halaat wahan ke badalte gaye, dono communities ke haathon mein se ye chala gaya. Now it is not in their hand. हाँ, मैं कहता हूँ एक दिन कश्मीरी पंडित अपनी एक लीडरशिप तैयार करके एक जुलूस की सूरत में वैली में दाखिल हो जाएं. आप देखें वहाँ जितने ये यहाँ से आएंगे उससे तीन गुना ज्यादा लोग इनको वहाँ इस्तकबाल के लिए मिलेंगे. इनको मकान घर तामीर करने की जरूरत नहीं है, हमारे घरों में जगह है. इनको जमीन खरीदने की जरूरत नहीं है, इनकी जमीन जो अभी तक वहाँ ही जो बेची नहीं खुद, बिकॉज मोस्ट ऑफ द पंडित ब्रदर्स दे हैव सोल्ड देयर प्रॉपर्टी इन कश्मीर. But whosoever have not sold, it is there intact. 20-25 साल अगर आप अपना घर छोड़ देते हैं तो आप देखिए उसकी क्या हालत होती है. उसी हालत में वो घर वहां पड़े हुए हैं. तो ऐसा कोई मसला नहीं है. One day they decide that they have to come back. They will come back and they will find their Muslim brothers in their way.
Okay. Next question here. Then the next from that side, because that side is being neglected. I think बहुत लोग सवाल पूछना चाहते हैं. जल्दी जल्दी जवाब देंगे. जल्दी सवाल पूछेंगे.
नमस्कार सर. सर एक कश्मीरी क्या चाहता है? एक कश्मीरी क्या चाहता है कि वो हिंदुस्तान में रहना चाहता है, कश्मीर में ही रहना चाहता है या पाकिस्तान में रहना चाहता है? क्योंकि इस बार 72% जो है वो मेजॉरिटी ने इलेक्शन में इंडिया की ये बता रहे हैं कि इंडिया में रहना चाहते हैं, कश्मीरी हिंदुस्तान की तरफ हैं, लेकिन एक सच्चा कश्मीरी क्या चाहता है? मैं किसी भी तरीके, मैं एक पंडित हूँ, लेकिन मैं ये समझना चाहता हूँ कि कश्मीरी क्या चाहता है, क्योंकि मसला तो वही है।
हाँ, मैं जवाब दूँ, शुड आई आंसर? सबसे पहले तो ये एक पॉलिटिकल क्वेश्चन है, मुझे नहीं लेना चाहिए, लेकिन आप क्योंकि एक जर्नलिस्ट हूँ, इस तरह के सवालों से मुझे वास्ता पड़ता रहता है। कश्मीरी क्या चाहता है? सबसे पहले यार, कश्मीरियों को इकट्ठे मिल के बैठने दो कहीं। जब सारे कश्मीरी एक जगह इकट्ठे मिल के बैठेंगे, तब वो सर जोड़ेंगे। मेरे साथ गिगू साहब होंगे, मैं होंगे, खान साहब होंगे, सरदार जी होंगे, वहाँ थॉमस होगा, हम सब बैठेंगे। जम्मू का मेरा वो महेंद्र सिंह होगा, हम बैठेंगे, हम डिसाइड करेंगे। अभी देखिए, एक कम्युनिटी मेरी यहाँ पर रेगिस्तानों में धूल चाट रही है, एक कम्युनिटी है जो पार सरहद के उस तरफ है, दूसरी एक कम्युनिटी है जो कश्मीर में मुसीबतें बर्दाश्त कर रही है, 7 लाख फौज वहाँ पर अभी भी है, तीसरी चौथी कम्युनिटी है वो जो ना इनको पसंद है, ना मुझे पसंद है, ना आपको पसंद है। तो हम बटे हुए हैं, बिखरे हुए हैं। और जब वो बंदरिया का छोटा सा किस्सा है कि जब सैलाब आया तो बंदरिया ने अपने बच्चे को उठा के पेट के साथ लगाया, जब पानी यहाँ तक पहुँचा तो उसने कंधे के साथ लगाया, और जब पानी कंधे पर पहुँचा तो उसने सर पर बिठाया, लेकिन जब पानी यहाँ पहुँचा तो इसी बच्चे को उठाकर पाँव के नीचे रखा और खुद उस पर खड़ी हो गई, क्योंकि उसकी अपनी जान पर बनाई। जब अपनी जान पर बनाती है तो एक माँ भी अपने बच्चे को उठा के पाँव के नीचे रखती है अपनी जान बचाने के लिए। हमारी जान पर बनी हुई है, हमें कहीं बैठने दो, हमें थोड़ा सा वो पानी उतरे वहां से, हम फैसला करेंगे क्या करना है।
Okay, next question. Get up, tell us your name.
I'm Shreyas Bharadwaj from Mysore, Karnataka. So from my mother's side of the family, we trace our ancestries back to the Brahmins Shankara, Adi Shankara took to Kashmir when he went over there to establish the Shankara Peeth. So in the past 2 years when I lived in Bangalore, I met a lot of the Kashmiri young Kashmiri Muslims who spent 2 months of their year every year in Kashmir. So the sentiment I came across when I had my conversations with them, they don't want the Pandits back. They consider it to be their land, and it's somewhat of a demographic divide between the Muslims over there and Hindus. So when my father traveled through Kashmir a while back, he sensed somewhat a similar sentiment. So is there a non-demographic situation to the entire Kashmir issue, or does it have to be a demographic issue of there being a complete Muslim and Hindu divide?
Very difficult question, to be honest with you, and I wish I could answer your question. I am sorry, because it's something I have been thinking about myself, you know. It's very difficult, you know, unless you talk to a lot of people and find out what they say, how they feel, what they've gone through, you know, you can't answer that question. Yeah. I don't want to lie or maybe give you an answer based on what I think. That's not important. But to a large extent, these are books, you know. This book, for instance, which I've edited, I've not written. A lot of people who have written these things, you know. So it'd be good if you read these books instead of asking a writer, what do you think? Doesn't matter what a writer thinks.
Sorry, I was just trying to figure out the lady gets to speak. Yeah, and these are literary pundits. They're not all political pundits. Get up, my dear, and tell us who you are.
Hello, my name is Kritika. Good evening, Siddharth sir. Good evening, Sahil sir. Sir, I'm a student of English literature and also a defense aspirant. Some years from now, I'll be landing up in a situation where I'll be having a pen in one hand and a rifle in another. So the irony about this thing is, I want from you to know what, according to you, is the best idea for the youth of India to restore peace in my valley, in our valley.
Idea is already given to you, my dear, because my daughter Yasmin is just, you know, close to your age. So it reminds me, I have not seen her for last 1 week. You have already idea. The Constitution of India is itself an idea, and where everybody is free. A democracy, the world's largest democracy. Just practice democracy, and that is the idea. Just reject fanatism in every shape. Separatism, and extremism in every state. It is not only a Muslim labeled fanatic, a Muslim extremist or something. There are extremists on the other side as well. So the moment until the time we promote extremism, we support extremism on the both ways, we will have problems. Just reject and just discourage extremism, and India will become the Sone Ki Chidiya.
I think this is a question which has vexed so many people. They, fortunately, they don't have rifles in their hand. They have pens. And I would say poetry is the answer, but a very inadequate answer. So I think I agree, but you cannot realistically expect them to give the answer to a question which has vexed the whole world.
No, but I appreciate she's thinking about this, you know.
It's wonderful that you're thinking about
this. This is the question you should not ask us. This is the question you should ask yourself, and you should talk about it, and you should write about it, and you should write about the possible solutions.
Youth can play a role. Youth have a role. Youth can play a role. And that role is listen to everybody. If I have some complaints against you, just sit with me and listen to me. If we have some complaints in Kashmir with Delhi, they should listen to us. They reject the leadership which is having complete hold on the situation. They called it separatism, separatist leaders. They call them Pakistani leaders. And only one Sayyid Ali Gilani, who is the most hardcore leader believed to be in Kashmir, do you know what he says? He says, we have been promised by late Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru and then Mahatma Gandhi that in 1947, Indian Army went there on an arrangement. We have some resolutions in United Nations. According to them, we have been promised that we will give you a chance to decide your future. He says, the most hardcore leader says, if tomorrow my people decide to go with India, I will be very happy. But just give me a chance. Just listen to me. Until you listen to your younger brother, complaint, you can't make friendship with him. So just listen to the people.
There's one. So it's an important question. It's wonderful to see such a large audience all thinking. And it's wonderful to know that the people on the stage are thinking the same thing. I'm really sorry, but the next session is about to begin. There's one question there. And then while they sign their books, you can quickly ask them questions while they are signing their books.
Sir, at the risk, my name is Surbhi. I'm a journalist from Ahmedabad. At the risk of being punitive, do you think it's unfair that writers are being asked to answer political questions, one, and two, that whatever you write about, that is being, that writing...
Imagination solutions come through in Jaipur always. You got to clap for them before you rush to the next session.
Thank you so much, and we thank our sponsor.